Good morning and welcome to Eastside. We're going to start our worship in just a moment, but I want to take a few minutes to share some of the great things coming up here at the church. Take me out to the ball game and buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jacks. Eastside is heading to the ball game. On August 28th, Eastsiders will be heading to the Royals game. If you'd like to register for tickets, you can email Pastor Don at don.clappin@eschurch.com or call the church office at 816-796-0955. Our ES kids will be hosting our Power Up VBS from August 4th through the 8th from 6 to 8 each night. There is no pre-registration required and it's free. Be sure to tell other families in your life so their kids can learn about Jesus in a fun, safe environment here at the church. We are still looking for volunteers for VBS, so if you'd like to play a part, simply head out to the information desk in the West Lobby after service to sign up. If this is your first time here at Eastside, we want to take a moment to say thank you for joining us today. In the seat back in front of you, there's a connection card. Simply fill out that card with the information that you're comfortable with giving and take it to the information center in the West Lobby. We know that visiting a new church can be scary and confusing, so when you take your card to the information center, you can ask any questions about the church that you might have, and we'd love to give you a gift as our way of letting you know you're always welcome here. You are now in the loop. If you want to stay up to date with what's going on here at the church and be encouraged throughout your week, simply go like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter and Instagram. We believe that Sundays are the best day of the week, and you picked the best place to be this morning.
Well, good morning. I don't know what you guys thought, but that guy's pretty handsome. Which guy? Don't even. Well, good morning. Welcome to Eastside. We're going to get started with... Oh, that already happened. How are you? Wow, you guys are so alive and energized today. I'm so happy. We have a great morning. We have Pastor Don speaking this morning as he's going to wrap up. Wow. You paid them. Got it. That makes a lot of sense. Well, we have an amazing morning this morning, but I wanted to talk about 2019 because 2019 for Eastside is kind of a really big year. Our lead pastor, Pastor Fred, and his wife, Miss Laura, are going to be celebrating 20 years here at Eastside, which is crazy. Yeah, absolutely. So if you can imagine, when Pastor Fred came on and became my pastor, I was 5 years old. I'm so sorry. For some of you, that hit a real low point. But it's a big deal. So at each exit, you'll see orange boxes that you can throw a couple extra dollars into to play your part in Eastside's gift to Pastor Fred and Miss Laura. And then after service today, if you head out those doors, up the stairs, past the cafe, take a left and then another left, you come hang out with me because we're filming a video for Pastor Fred and Miss Laura as a thank you and a way to show our appreciation for them. And if you're not good on camera, that's okay, neither am I, but every week I get to be up there and you all watch, which is amazing every week. But we're going to have an amazing morning. If this is your first time here, this is how it's going to go. We're going to sing some songs. We're going to worship together. We're going to take offering. And then Pastor Don is going to share his heart up here as we wrap up our summer stretch series. But right now, let's just stand and worship the Lord together.
Well, I'd like to say good morning again. Let's start this off by clapping our hands. We're going to sing to our risen Savior. Amen. He's our only King forever. Solid crown, as nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. And we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. Unmatched is wisdom.
Unmatched all your wisdom. In love and justice you will reign. Every knee will bow. We bring our expectations. Our hope is anchored in your name. The name of Jesus. Oh, we trust the name of Jesus. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only.
He's coming to fight our battles, right? And he is victorious, right? Even though the world seems cloudy, it seems hard to focus on what is going on in the heavens and on earth. We have to remind ourselves that he has come, he has won, and he is the only King forever, right? Let's get ready to lift our banners high as we sing this song. Just really just give it all to the Lord this morning. Next song, we're going to sing about how his love is just fierce and it conquers over all, right? Let's lift this one up. Before I call, before I ever cry, you answer me from where the thunder hides. I can't outrun this heart I'm tethered to. Every step I collide with you. I'm like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. You cannot fail. The only thing I've found is through it all, you've never let me down. You don't hold back, relentless in pursuit. At every turn, I come face to face with you. Like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce like a hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Surround me. Chase me down. Seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me found? Chase me down, seek me out. How could I be lost when you have called me? Let's lift that up. Chase me down, seek me out. And how could I be lost when like a tidal wave crashing over me, rushing in to meet me here. Your love is fierce, the hurricane that I can't escape, tearing through the atmosphere. Your love is fierce. Your love. We thank you for the fierce love. Church, you can go ahead and have a seat. And at this time, we're going to prepare for giving. We're going to invite the ushers forward. We just want to say thank you to everyone here who's made it a priority to give here at Eastside. It's because of you we're able to live out our mission here in Independence, and that's to help people discover and rediscover Jesus. And we're going to sing a song here as we go into offering. About how God is truly the King of our hearts. So at this time, we're going to pray, and then we're going to sing again. Just focus your eyes in on God. Just remind yourself, God, you are the King of my heart. You're the King of our hearts here, Lord. And just really connect with him as we sing this next song. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you and we thank you. God, we thank you for being the one true King. We thank you for loving us. Right now, I pray a blessing over this offering, Lord. Use it to build your kingdom here. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let the King of my heart be fountain where I run, the fountain I drink from. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the shadow where I hide, the ransom for my life. Oh, he is my song. 'Cause you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good.
Oh, church, stand with us in worship.
Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the wind inside my sails, the anchor in the waves. Oh, he is my song. Let the king of my heart be the fire inside my veins, the echo of my days. Oh, he is my song. 'Cause you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good.
You're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Oh, we tasted and we
you're
sing.
Never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
Oh, you're never gonna
let, you're never gonna let me down.
You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. Oh, no, no. You're never gonna let me down. 'Cause you are.
As our prayer, Lord, you are good, you're good.
Oh, you are good, you're good. Oh, you are good, you're good.
Church, you may be seated.
So glad to see you this morning. I'm older. I'm glad for these younger guys. They did real well. Okay, I'm excited for them. I thank God for our young guys. I really do. We have to have young people in here. We have to have people that are going to take over in a little while, because I also have to have people that in 20 years from now I can laugh at. They're going to be fatter, balder, older, grayer, and be saying things that nobody else gets, just like me, around the office. So I'm thrilled for them, and I love and enjoy working with them, and they've done a great job, and looking forward just as the future goes with them here on staff. I'm also excited Pastor Fred will be back next week, and he'll be here. Yeah, that's worth it. Listen, after today, you might be applauding on standing ovation, all right? He'll be back next week, and I'm really thrilled about that. He gets all geared up, ready to go, and he's ready, and I'm thrilled about that being here next week. And also, I'm really excited about his 20 years. Amen. That's a lot, folks. That is a lot. I'll share with you this, and I've been in this all my life with my dad was a pastor, and we moved about every 5 years. So to get a man that'll stay with you for 20 years and be your pastor, investing in you Sunday after Sunday, week after week, in your life, in your homes, counseling with you and everything else that he's done over these years, that's a lot. That's not an average for most people. And so I thank God that we've got a pastor and a leader like that. And so in my old time, I'll use a word from the 80s, we're going to have a rad day today, all right? All right. So I want to talk to you. As you're getting ready for this message, and I was preparing, you just ever have one of those weekends that are just, it doesn't go right. And you all had them. And every time I get ready to speak, there's always something that goes on, and I'm thinking, why is this happening? Why? And so I get up, you know, Friday, and we're heading to Oregon, Missouri, and we were doing a wedding in Oregon, Missouri. I didn't even know there was an Oregon, Missouri, but there is. I've been there. They don't have a t-shirt, or I'd have bought it, but it's an Oregon, Missouri, and it's a beautiful place, and there was a beautiful little area that we could do a wedding there, and it was nice, and so we traveled all the way up there, and that was great, and come back Saturday. My son is using my lawnmower. The lawnmower breaks. In the morning, he calls me that. I go outside, and I see a flat tire on my car. Luckily, we had my wife's car. We jumped in that. So these things they're not fixable. They're just irritating, right? Come on, let's just be honest about it. They're frustrating. Well, during that weekend, my son has been doing yard work and doing other things for other people, mowing and different things, and he gets poison ivy. So we got poison ivy in the house, all right? And I'm sitting there, and so he has, you know, my wife does laundry on Saturdays usually, but I drug her up here to Oregon with me, and she spent the day with me, and so we didn't get to all the laundry like we usually do during the week. And so I did say, please just wash these things so we make sure we have them, and okay. And so we didn't get to the towels. My kids are home, and they use a towel every time they walk in the bathroom, it seems. They don't know what it's like to hang it on the hook that we put mounted on there in the bathroom. So I got up this morning and went to my towel. I threw in the dirty clothes because I thought we were washing them. I forgot we couldn't wash them. Not blaming my wife at all. So I thought, well, okay, I'll go out there. We got plenty of towels. I opened up the little closet area. No towels. I got a shower. So luckily, my wife is a connoisseur of buying hand towels. So I showered and then dried off with a hand towel. I'm a big dude. I'm telling you something right now. I dried my head, my face, my shoulders, and the rest of it was drying like with a wet wipe. I mean, it was just as bad it was. So I've settled this. I'm going to put in a lock on my bath, on my bedroom door. We're going to put racks in there so we can have the towels. And then we're going to put an eye scanner to get into our bedroom. Only my wife and a retina scanner, so only my wife and I can get in there. And then I'm going to make her wear a weighted vest because I know they can't drag me very far. So if they knock her out trying to steal the towels, they have something that they have to go through. And then I'm going to give them out like a hotel. Help save the whales. All right? You're getting one towel. That's it. For a month. All right? Figure it out. So, but that was my weekend, and I'm getting ready to speak, and I'm thinking to myself, Don, you got to check your attitude, and I'm talking about that today, and I'm thinking to myself, God, you're so funny. God's funny. He's funny. I want to read to you about, we're going to talk a little bit today about not being your ordinary neighbor. And most of the time we think about neighbor, we think about our next door neighbor. We think maybe the neighbor on our block and our cul-de-sac or down the street from us. But I want to share with you that neighbor means more than that. Understand this. The Hebrew says that neighbor is someone who is near. In there, it says, the Hebrew says it's someone you're associated with. The Greek says it's someone who you're near. And who we're associated with, I mean, now that we're on Facebook and we've reassociated some old relationships, that's a wide neighborhood of people. Because of all the social media that we have today, we're in a wide area of having neighbors. We're in a big, large neighborhood. You have a large neighborhood that you associate with, that you are intermingling with all the time. And so today, it's not just your next door neighbor, or it's not just the person in your family, or just somebody that you happen to be real close friends with. I'm going to talk to you today about being the type of neighbor just to those people that are around you, that you come in contact with, that you're associated with, that you come near to. And so we're going to read a passage of scripture here in just a minute. And it's not your ordinary neighbor today. And we're talking about this. And this story is something that you're probably familiar with. Most people are familiar with the term a good Samaritan. Everybody wants a good Samaritan. But I'm going to talk to you today. So we're going to read this passage. And then I want to change it up a little bit if you give me some freedom. And I want to look at the story again differently. So let's read this passage here. And we're in Luke chapter 10. And we're going to be in, by the way, I got bifocals. I know you're not really excited about that. I am. I don't have to look like a goober by putting my glasses up all the time. I can read now. I'm excited. So, we're going to read in the message, but I'm going to read it with you. So, it says then, Jesus, let me set this up to you. Jesus is sitting there in this area. And remember, he's being hounded by religious leaders all the time. They're trying to stump him, trying to mess with him. And he's in here ministering. He's doing Jesus things. And they're all the time coming at him, trying to bombard him, trying to get him, trip him up, whatever, to make him look foolish. And Jesus is just so cool. He doesn't berate them. He doesn't bash them. He doesn't say. He just says, he just handles them calmly, wisely. And by the time they're done, they're just like going, oh. He doesn't have to kill him. He just handles him. That's what I love about it. And it says this. Then a religion scholar stood up with a question to test Jesus and said, Teacher, what do I need to do to get eternal life? And he answered unto this guy, he said, What's written in God's law? How do you interpret it? Now, before you change it, remember, these guys are studying the law. The answer is already here. What they've got in their hands. Now, it's not the full completed scripture, but what they got, he already knows. He's trying to trip up Jesus. Jesus just asked him a question back. Well, what does it say? You know what it says. Go on. He said that you love the Lord your God with all your passion, prayer, muscle, and intelligence, and that you love your neighbor as well as you do yourself. Next, said, good answer, said Jesus. I like the way Jesus said it. Well, that's a good answer. You're not so dumb. You're bright. Said, do it and you'll live. Looking for a loophole. See, the guy tried to twist him. Jesus said, this is simple, plain stuff. So the guy's like looking for a loophole, and he asked, and just how would you define neighbor? Jesus goes on and answers him by telling him a story. There was once a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. On the way, he was attacked by robbers. They took his clothes, beat him up, and went off, leaving him half dead. Luckily, a priest was on his way down the same road. But when he saw him, he angled across to the other side. And then a Levite, a religious man, showed up. And he also avoided the injured man. But then a Samaritan traveling the road came on him. And when he saw the man's condition, his heart went out to him. And he gave him first aid, disinfecting him and bandaging him and in all his wounds. And then he lifted him up onto his donkey, led him to an inn, and made him comfortable in the morning. And then in the morning, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper and saying, take good care of them. If it costs any more, put it on my bill. I'll pay you on my way back. And what do you think? Which one of the three became the neighbor to the man attacked by the robbers? The one who treated him kindly, the religion scholar said, responded. And Jesus said, well, then just go do the same. Now, I want you to understand something about this. This is not a command. This is not telling you that if you don't do this, God's going to punish you. If you don't do this or follow this story, God's going to get you. Jesus was just telling a story to him to simply get him to start thinking. And guys, that's what God wants from us. We don't have to be told every step of the way what to do. God gave you a brain. He blessed you with a mind. Creative, intelligent. You're sharp individuals. And he wants you to take that mind and apply it to what he wrote in the scripture, but he's not forcing you to do this. He did not tell that religious leader, if you don't do this, this is what's going to happen to you. He said, he made him answer. He said, who is it? He said, well, the guy at the end. I mean, the Samaritan, he was the best guy. Well, then just go do the same thing. But he didn't say, if you don't. He left it up to him. So I want to take the story for a minute, if you would. Give me a little bit of freedom. And I'm not changing the scriptures. I just wanted to say, what if? What if we looked at it this way? See, let's look at it this way. They had to come in contact with each other. They were all in the same area because they were going down the same road. So what if they knew each other? And I'm going to use their characters as their name. Priest is priest. Levite is Levite. Traveler is just traveler. And then there's Samaritan. That's their names. But what if all four of them knew each other and had contact with each other prior to this tragedy in his life? So here goes the story. These four guys were all in a marketplace. All right? They're hanging out. And he took off, and they're in Jerusalem, and they're going to Jericho. And they took off from this marketplace. So they're down there selling their goods. Everybody's walking around. If you know, in that time, these marketplaces were like farmers' market. You're walking around just getting from whoever's got a booth. You're buying whatever you can buy. You're buying your baskets. You're buying your food. You're buying your garments, your clothes, everything else like that. So Traveler comes in. Now I want to tell you something. I think Traveler was wealthy. You don't rob a poor guy, right? Common sense, you rob a guy that's got something worth having. And I think Traveler was noticeable. We always want to make this guy, you know, Traveler, to be so poor and needy, and everybody's going to stop and help the needy. Of course everybody's going to stop and help the needy. But I think Traveler had a side to him that people didn't like. To be honest with you, I think Traveler's kind of jerky, obnoxious, loud. He walked into the room and in that area there in the courtyard, and he was making his presence known. You know, hey, how you doing? Good to see you, Bill. High five. And he was there, had the nicest clothes on, big rings, big gold chains, everything there. He had the Nike or whatever tennis shoes you want to put on him, big Adidas, whatever. I mean, he had it all. He's walking around. He had all the gold bling on his garments, okay? He walked in. He made his presence known. He was traveler. Traveler, I've been around the world. Don't need to mess with me. I've been and seen more than you could ever imagine. I'm traveler. So traveler's there, and he sees priest. Now, priest is a pastor. He's a pastor of a local church. And traveler has been in his congregation. Traveler has been with him on several things, and they've done church issues. But him and traveler kind of had a falling out because they didn't agree. So traveler sees him and approaches priest, and he tells priest, "Hey, priest, look, I'm tired of you. I just want to tell you this, and I don't care who hears it. I'm tired of you, and I'm not coming back to your church anymore. Don't bring your Jesus to me anymore. I'm sick of it, and I hope that you get voted out and thrown out of that church." And he tells priest, "Don't you come around me anymore, and if you come near me, you're going to be in trouble." Now, wouldn't you hate to have that kind of confrontation? And traveler tells priest that. Priest's sitting there, he's crushed, he's hurt. He's scared now. He's like, "Man, I don't want to mess with this guy. I don't want to get in trouble. He might sue me, might do something to me." So after that conversation is done, he turns around and he sees Levite. And Levite sees him, and he goes over to him and said, Levite waves at him, "Traveler, what's up, man? Glad you're back. Good to see you." He said, "Listen, I've been doing these things in the community and through my religious foundation. I want you to come and be a part of it, Traveler. You know, our board, we're meeting, and I know that you created that board. And as the chairman of your board, I want to tell you that I'm excited. I'm excited about what we're going to be able to do this next year and everything, and I'm excited about some of the money we raised." And Traveler looks at Levite and says, "Levite, look, man, I needed to tell you this. I don't really have need for you anymore. I've got a guy over here, and I think he's better equipped for the job, and I know that you've been chairman on my board, and I appreciate that, but I'm just not going to need you anymore, and I know you're influential in the community because you get a lot of religious support and stuff, but nah, you're done. You know, I just don't think you have what it takes to cut the mustard, and I don't need you anymore. I'm kind of really tired of you, and I just want to get this out in the open so we don't have any problem." And Levi looks at Traveler. He said, "Are you serious?" He goes, "Yeah." He said, "Don't even come to the next board meeting. I've already changed presidents. I don't need you." Levi's sitting there going, "What?" He's hurt. He's crushed. And then he just walks away. Traveler goes over to Samaritan's booth because there's something there that he has to get. Samaritan's selling some of these homemade baskets and different things that he needs, and so he's got product that he needs. And he goes over to Samaritan. Now understand, Samaritan is not the guy that you usually want to be around. He's a brawler. He's rough. He's not really society's picture of what an example should be. And so he's just that kind of guy that he's not the guy that you want your daughter bringing home to mom, all right? He's just not that guy. But he's fair. He works hard. He makes a living honestly and tries to do the best he can. But there's just an edginess about him that he's not accepted most of the time. And everybody knows it. Priest didn't accept him very well. Levi didn't accept him very well. They were kind of on board with Traveler about this, that he's just not that guy. But Traveler had to do business with him. But I'm going to be honest with you about it. Him and Traveler had business together. And Samaritan was honest. But Traveler, no. Traveler would take advantage of Samaritan. He'd shortchange him, cheat him. Tell him he was going to pay him at certain times and then wouldn't pay him. Now, this traveler guy is kind of a jerk, isn't he? You get the idea? It's pretty bad. And so as traveler's going down the road, he's telling Samaritan, "You're going to do this, this, and this." And he's like, "Hey, look, man, I'll tell you when I'm going to pay you." And Samaritan just backs off and said, "Look, whatever." So they do their dealing and he leaves. Now, Traveler gets on in his ride. Let's put it in our terms today. He gets in this nice car. He's got a nice Sierra, GMC Sierra. It's got the 6-bed things on it. You know, he's driving in it really nice. He's got some stuff. He's got all his things. And he's driving down the road. Has a flat. Gets out. And all of a sudden, these guys jump him. They've been following him since the marketplace. They jump him. Take all his supplies, all his things, take his car, take his clothes, take everything, leave him, and beat him up. They beat him up. Now, at this point in time, understanding Traveler the way I've been telling you, he deserves it. But they beat him up, take his stuff, take him and leave. Just leave him there. Almost leave him there to die, basically. In a little bit while, here comes Priest. He's traveling down the road. And he sees Traveler. He notices him. There's something about him that still had that he noticed. And he said, I know who that guy is. And Priest said, man, he just warned me. I don't know what's going on. I'm scared. I don't know what he's into. And so Priest decides to cross the road. He said, I just don't want to be near him. Now, let me say something. Before we bash him, which we usually do, these religious leaders, because they left him, understand something. Priest was scared. He had just been threatened. He had just been told what would happen to him. And a lot of times in stories, in this story, we always want to throw them under the bus like they should have done something. But folks, in our lives sometimes, when we face people like that, we don't always want to do something. Right? I've been in that predicament. And I'd rather just go the other direction. Why? I don't have to face it. I don't have to confront it. So before we jump all over him and blame him, let's understand him a little bit. He's scared to death. So Priest walks off and goes the other way. Levite comes up. Right after Priest, he sees Priest across the road, and there's Levite, and he comes up afterwards, and he goes, oh, no, it's Traveler. And instantly when he saw Traveler, his hurt, his pain, his rejection all came back up. And you know what Levite did? Levite just went to the other side. And before we throw him under the bus, understand this. Sometimes we're so hurt, we're so in pain, it's not safe for us to help. It's not logical for us to help in some ways. Even though you say, well, the scripture said he'll give you the strength. Yeah, but sometimes you don't have it. It's not for you, maybe. It's not at the right moment. Could he have helped him? Yes. But he was hurt. He was crushed, devastated. He just lost it all by the hands of that man. And I know, and I'm not speaking for any of you. I'll tell you, just like Jesus said, you hear this and you figure it out. But I know in me, I've been Levite. I've been him. And I've not been ready to help, and I've not been ready to aid, and I've walked to the other side. So Samaritan comes, and he sees Traveler laying on the road. And he looks at Traveler and he sees him. Now the Bible says that he had compassion on him. His heart felt compassion for him. He felt for him. But can I throw this in there? These guys are humans. And don't you think, just like yourself, I do for me, that even though I had compassion, I struggled a little bit before I went over there? Don't you think? I would have. And so before I went over there to Traveler, and I'm going that way, I'm headed that direction, in my mind I'm thinking, man, he's beaten up pretty bad. Wow. Man, I hope he understands. I hope he learns. I hope he learns his lesson. I hope he got it knocked into him now that he's not that great. That's what we think sometimes. But let me show you this on this, and I'm going to go into this point here in a little bit. But Traveler picked him up. He picked him up, put antiseptic on him, cleaned his wounds. Maybe he dumped a little extra antiseptic just so it burned a little bit. You know what I'm saying? Come on. A little salt. It'll cure it quicker. You know? Press down a little hard on the wound. That's what we want to do, don't we? We want to be vindicated. Yeah. You know, I'll help you out. Put the tourniquet on too tight and the neck brace real tight, you know. Can you breathe? Good. You know, be all right. Hold on. And he picked him up, set him on the his donkey. He took off. I'd say he set him in his truck and he ran him up there to the hotel, put him in the hotel, made sure he had everything he needed, got taken care of, and what did he do for him? He even paid the bill, and then he left money and said, hey, listen, you understand, Samaritan didn't have a lot of money. He didn't have a lot of things. He wasn't rich. I've heard this story told that, you know, Samaritan had a lot of money and he did this and he could just do. No, it wasn't as amazing if he had that kind of money because it's just something he could do. But he did it even though it's going to cost him something. It's going to cost him something. So as we look at Samaritan's life, I want you to understand something. He struggled. He's human just like we are. He's no greater than you and I. He's no different than you and I. But what I want you to see out of Samaritan is that he had three things about him that made him not ordinary. And on your sheet is observation number one. Is be a neighbor that doesn't look, just look, but sees the need. You just don't look at the person and see something. You see the need. So easy for us sometimes just to always look. We're passing by and we're going, man, yeah, they got some issues. Yeah, but we don't stop to see the deeper need. We got to stop and see what's going on in their life. Why is their reaction the way their reaction is? Why are they doing what they're doing? Why are we acting and feeling the way we're feeling? Like I told you, there's more to it. If you just saw me yesterday when my mower was broke and my flat tire, and this morning when I didn't have a towel, my reaction wouldn't have been probably the most godliest. And you would have probably just looked and seen, man, that dude's got issues. You try to be me and dry off with a hand towel. That's the big issue. But be a neighbor that doesn't just look. He sees. We can see physical tragedy. And we can see beaten and bloody and robbed. But a lot of times we can't see the emotional tragedy or maybe what's happened to them that's causing this. I want you to watch this video, then I'm going to add a little bit more to the story. So watch this video with me, if you would. What you just seen there, I guarantee you, is happening right here. In this room, today. And let me share something with you. Samaritan was not some just godly man and had this conversation with God, God speaking into his ear. He was a normal man like you and I. And he allowed God to open up his heart and use him during that time. And we all have God in us, and we have the ability to be used by God if we'll just open up our heart and our life. See, let me add to the story real quick. Samaritan, of all people, probably should have left him. This guy and him have never got along. But you know what Samaritan knew about him? Is that Samaritan's wife worked with Traveler's wife. Traveler was losing his job. His company was failing. Traveler's wife was telling Samaritan's wife, yeah, I've been cheating on my husband. She was stepping out on Traveler. He didn't even know it. He was finding it out. There was issues there. And Traveler, all that time in the marketplace, was just keeping face so nobody would know his hurt, nobody would know his pain, nobody would know any of his agony, anything he was going through. But he didn't know that Samaritan knew. See, Samaritan didn't just look at the beaten, bloody guy. Those are easy to see. Samaritan looked deeper and saw the tragedy inside. He saw the pain inside. He saw the effects of why he was acting the way he was acting, why he was lashing out. He saw the other pain that was in his life. That's what Traveler's seeing. I mean, a Samaritan's seen about Traveler. And so when I tell you this, it leads to observation number two. It says this: be a neighbor who goes the extra mile in his compassion. Traveler didn't, he got compassion from Samaritan because Samaritan went the extra mile in his compassion. He didn't just feel sorry for him because of all this action. He knew deeper what was going to happen. He left that money, he left those things in that innkeeper's hand at that time because why? He knew that Traveler was going to be failing here in about a week or so. He knew that by the time that he, as Samaritan, got back through to pay the bill, there was going to be more on the tab because Traveler wasn't going to have it. And Samaritan took care of it all. It was a sacrifice for him. Observation number three is this: be a neighbor who's selfless. See, Samaritan became selfless. Not selfish, but selfless. He sacrificed. And when you're selfless, it's going to take sacrifice. It's going to take a risk. It's going to take something in you to keep going, and you're going to have to go that extra mile. And being selfless means that you're going to have to sacrifice your time, money, emotion, hurt, pain, heartache, relationships. That's what's going to take place when you try to be the good neighbor. When you try to be the neighbor that's not just an ordinary guy, ordinary neighbor that sits back and goes, well, hope you make it. But you got to get involved. It's going to take that. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This doesn't mean that you had to be this guy's best friend. In the story, it never said that Traveler and Samaritan got together afterwards and Traveler said, hey, let me buy you dinner. By the way, man, you did so much for me. I'm going to name my son after you. This is Samaritan. He's named after you. He didn't do that. As a matter of fact, in that scripture, it never says that they ever met again. What he did is he did what God led him to do. What he did is he saw a need in somebody deeper than just the outward appearance. He saw it deeper. And he looked at him deeper. And what I'm telling you right now is we come in here as a family. We say we're family. You're the family of Eastside. And we come in here Sunday after Sunday after Sunday with the same kind of things that are going on in that video. You know what? As a pastor and as a guy that's been on this staff for several years, I can't handle everybody's pain in here. I can't handle everybody's heartache. And I'll be honest with you, I'm human. I'm going to accidentally overlook and not see in to what's going on in you and what you're going through. And if you tell me sometimes, you know what, I'm going to forget. And I'm going to see you Sunday morning and go, man, how's it going? Man, I just told you. You know, my world just fell apart last week. I'm sorry. You know why? Because other people in this church, their world's falling apart. I want you to understand something. God wants to use you. And so why am I bringing this to you? Because you need to be the Samaritan. I'm going to do the best I can be to be that neighbor that's not ordinary. But I need your help, and I need you to be the neighbor that's not ordinary. And you know what? Sometimes God's going to give you a place in that position to be that kind of neighbor. You know what he's going to do with you? He's going to use you. He's going to help you. And you're going to be able to help somebody's life turn around. And you're going to change somebody's outcome. And then you know what else is going to happen? Sometimes you're going to get, choose my words, you're going to get pooped on. It's the safest word I can tell you. In a relationship, you're just going to get messed on. And you know what? It might fail. And the attempt might be risky. And it might not, you might not be the person to help that person through it. You need to understand that. But I'm telling you something, folks, we don't stop just being extraordinary for God just because that happens. God wants to use you. God wants to bless you. God wants to take your hurt, your pain that you've gone through, and bless somebody else. See, Samaritan walked a wild life. He probably had marriages that failed. He probably had businesses that went south. He'd probably been robbed before. He'd probably been beat up before. He probably watched his world crumble around him. And I'm telling you today, God used that man that nobody thought in society would ever be used, and God used him to turn another man's life around. I want to challenge you today. God wants you to be the extraordinary neighbor. Not just the ordinary neighbor. He wants to use you today, just like he did Samaritan. But remember, you can't just look, you got to see. You got to be willing to go the extra mile in compassion. And then you got to be selfless. Are you saying that's easy? Nope. I failed at all three many times. So what do? I get back up, dust myself off, ask God to forgive me, and I keep pressing forward. That's all you can do. You don't have to be a superhero to be used by God. He uses ordinary people to be extraordinary people. So my closing thought with you today is this. Don't just be an ordinary neighbor. When you go home today and you think about being a neighbor, don't be just ordinary. When people think about you, say, hey, there's something different about that guy. It's good. Something different about that girl. It's good. They're not ordinary. That's okay. Don't just be ordinary. Let God use you to be extraordinary, all right? Let's pray. God, we thank you for the time that we can be here today. We thank you for your love, your patience. We thank you for your grace. God, I know in this situation, I preach something that I know I failed at. I preach something that, Lord, I know that I have to work on all the time. And Lord, I'm not any different than anybody sitting in these chairs. We've all faced tragedy and heartache. And right now, today, there are people sitting in these chairs today that are just on the life's edge of ruin. I don't know it, but you do. And so I ask you, God, today that you will send somebody in their life like Samaritan, who will look past the outward, go for what's really going on in their life, be compassionate to the extra mile and selfless to help them. And I ask you today that you will take everyone in here, that they will have that opportunity the same, to change somebody else's life. But most of all, above anybody else, not for the glory of men, but that, God, we stand with you knowing that we've glorified you. I love you, God, for everything that you do. I love you for everything that you've done in me and allowing me to be here at this moment today. You're the best. Amen. Thank you for coming. Appreciate it.
desperate for you. I'm desperate for you. I surrender. Drench my soul as mercy and grace unfold. I hunger and thirst. I hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry. Speak to me now. Speak to me. I surrender, I surrender.